Thank you for joining us this evening for our Faithful Citizens Workshop. My name is Christina Crost. Pastor Onkwe is with us as well. And we have some special guests that will be joining us very shortly. And so once we see them hop on, we will probably hand them the mic. They're very busy and have a lot to do. So we want them to be able to say what they need to say before they're off to the next thing today. Oh, hello, Laura. Oh, Laura from Carbondale.
Welcome, everyone. This is Pastor Onkwe, the Policy Director, and we are excited tonight that you joined our Faithful Citizens Workshop. Christina Crost, the Policy Coordinator, and I have been looking forward to this evening, especially since we know that Representative Ann Williams and Representative Cam Buckner will be joining us on parts of this presentation just to give us a take and an update on how things are going with our climate bill negotiations. At this time, as the numbers are continuing to climb and people are joining, we are excited to present to you our Faithful Citizens Workshop, something we do at Faith in Place, just to let the people know who are connected to our organization, what's important to us. And so at this time, I'm gonna turn it over to Christina, and she's gonna take us through a couple slides.
Very good. So as I said, when we see Representative Williams jump in, we will probably stop what we're talking about and give her time to speak. We know her time is limited with us today. So if it seems like this gets a little squirrely here for a minute, that's okay. We're gonna go with the flow, and we're just so thankful to have Representative Williams and Representative Buckner with us today. All right, let's go to the next slide.
Christina, I'm about to add Representative Ann Williams in.
Terrific. Well, we'll start there. Let's give her a moment to breathe, though, shall we?
Thank you, Representative, for joining us. And we are excited that you are taking time out of your busy schedule. And I know you have a meeting in a very short time. And so, again, thank you for jumping on real quick. If you have any questions for our representative, please throw them in the chat. Our policy coordinator will be filtering those questions, and we'll try to get them to Representative Williams. Real quick, before we bring Representative Williams on, I do want Christina just to take you through a couple of intro slides so that you'll know exactly why we're here. So go ahead, Christina, and then we'll...
Very good. Thank you, Pastor Onkwe. So we're going to cover today who is Faith in Place. Why does advocacy matter, especially if you're a person of faith? I think what Faith in Place does is very unique. And so how can we use that strength, our faith, to make our advocacy matter? And then we will be talking about what happened at spring session, what's yet to happen about the climate bill, and where we go from here, a call to action of what people of faith can do. So that's what we're planning for this evening. And again, I'm Christina Crost, the policy coordinator. Pastor Onkwe is our policy director. I represent maybe a downstate rural East Central Illinois constituency. So that's where I'm located. And Pastor Onkwe is up in the Chicago area. Again, who are we? Faith in Place, our mission is that we educate, connect, and advocate for healthier communities. By using our faith, by using the strength that we have together in community to advocate for everyone as we need to care for our neighbors and our shared land, air, and water. And our vision is a diverse group of people of all faiths all over Illinois moving toward justice. But we know that there's only so much we can do individually. We will not recycle ourselves out of the climate crisis, sadly, because if that's all we had to do, this wouldn't be so important, right? But we know that we need to do those personal things, that personal change, the things we might do in our own homes to reduce our impact on the planet, but we also need to do the policy pieces as well. and advocate for just policy, because that's the bigger picture. That's the big piece that creates systems that are just and helps us to form healthier communities. And sometimes it seems like the numbers are stacked against us. Sometimes it seems like it is an insurmountable task to advocate for justice, whether it be climate justice or some other thing that you're passionate about. But we have seen study after study, and this one in particular, show that by Erica Chenoweth, that it only really takes 3.5% of a population engaged in sustained nonviolent resistance, or in our case, advocacy, to topple a brutal dictatorship, for example. But that 3.5% of the population is not that much. And if you think of your own, perhaps, faith community, of your own neighborhood, you might have that 3.5% of people who are concerned about what you're concerned about and are willing to advocate on behalf of that issue. So it's not that it takes a bazillion people to make it happen, but sustained action makes this work. Right. So again, because we are faith in place, we talk about how our faith informs our action. And that again is all faiths. I, in particular, am a Christian person. And so some of my faith heroes include the story of the parable of the unjust judge, or you may have heard it called the parable of the persistent widow, who advocated on her behalf to a judge and was asking for justice and was refused and refused and refused. And her sustained advocacy over time wore that judge down. And that judge finally ruled in her favor at one point, basically saying, "You're driving me nuts. Please stop." And so her sustained advocacy on her own behalf really mattered in this case. And so all faiths, all of our holy writings, whatever that may be, probably have examples of this kind of advocacy for justice for lots of different causes. And so I would encourage you to embrace or learn more about those stories from your faith traditions, and even drop them in the chat if you think of one in particular that resonates with you. I'd love to hear all these different stories about what inspires you to act and whom from your faith tradition inspires you to act. And with that, so people of faith, our power comes from holding our legislators accountable. And so again, we have some of those legislators here tonight that we want to hear from about what's going on with the climate legislation right now. So I think now might be a good time to pass it over to Pastor Onquay.
Yes, and we're going to bring Representative Williams on at this time. I don't see any questions, but we know we have been fighting for the Clean Energy Jobs Act to come into law for quite a while, especially this last legislative session where we came down to Springfield hoping that we were going to get a bill passed. And unfortunately, it did not happen or play out as we expected. We know that on Memorial Day, we were there in the Capitol very late that night, and we were hoping that something would happen. And we were disappointed, but we do have hope that negotiations continue. And so, Representative Williams, if you can just help us and give us some insight on how things are going with negotiations, and at this point, it'd be greatly appreciated.
Wonderful. Well, thank you, first of all, Pastor Onquay, for hosting me, and thank you to everyone at Faith in Place for your continued advocacy over the past, I would say, years now, months and years that we've been working on the Clean Energy Jobs Act. You truly have been a critical part of the coalition to move forward the issues that we're so concerned about with regard to climate and equity and ensuring that we can grow our green economy and spur the development of wind and solar. I did peruse the participant list, and I saw a lot of other strong advocates who also have partnered with the coalition to advance legislation in Springfield. So wanted to start with a big thank you. We wouldn't be where we are right now had the strong advocacy not happened from all the grassroots organizations. So that is really a starting point. You know, depending on how closely you followed the ups and downs of this legislation, and certainly there were a lot of ups and downs in terms of, you know, where we felt that we were going, if we were going to get a bill, when we were going to get a bill. It's not for lack of effort that we don't have a final product right now. Along with many colleagues of mine, advocacy organizations, community groups, faith organizations, we gave it our all, sustained that effort for the entire legislative session. At the end of the day, we were very committed, and I'm happy to be one of 40 plus legislators who signed a letter to our leadership, which said unequivocally, we will not support an energy package without strong equity provisions and without assurance that we have strong climate standards in place. So those were the kind of two foundational pieces for many of my colleagues in the General Assembly. Of course, in prior years, as we all know, the energy conversations have been dominated by the utility companies and the energy companies, to the point that the bills have historically been negotiated in the conference rooms of those utility companies. And with everything that happened with regard to ComEd and the ongoing scandal involving the utility company, we really had a different process this year. And the process, while maybe not as efficient as having the utilities just kind of dictate policy, certainly had the opinions of the organizations like Faith in Place at the forefront. So, you know, sometimes it's more challenging to do things the right way. And I think that's a little bit of what we faced this session. We had the advocacy, obviously, from the Clean Jobs Coalition. Many of you are member organizations. We had a strong advocacy effort from the Path to 100 folks. We had labor, of course, our partners in organized labor really pushing for jobs, both clean energy and the existing jobs in the power sector. So there were a lot of varied interests in place, notwithstanding, frankly, the fossil fuel companies, as well as our nuclear generator, Exelon. So when you put all those stakeholders and issue them the challenge of getting a bill, obviously many different opinions, you know, result. And we really, I will say, I'm happy to say that the process was legislator driven. It was advocate driven. And the utility companies did not dictate policy. They were involved only to the extent that they could discuss the implementation of the provisions that we talked about. So the good news, I have good news and bad news. I'll start with the good news because it's most of this is good news. The good news is that there are a number of areas that were important to Faith in Place and the Clean Energy Partners and the Clean Jobs Coalition that we found agreement on. Even areas that were difficult to achieve agreement, we were able to find consensus. So that's the positive news. And that was no easy feat. The bad news, though, is the remaining issues are the most challenging issues. And those include issues relating to climate and ensuring we have closure dates for fossil fuel plants in the bill, and also ensuring that our equity provisions are as strong as they can be. So two of the most important issues, not surprisingly, are the two of the issues that have consensus has not been reached. That being said, I'm going to echo what the pastor said in terms of being an optimist. The one thing that gives me a lot of hope that we will get it across the finish line some point soon, hopefully, is that we all share a sense of urgency, perhaps for different reasons, but we do, I know in this community, have a strong sense of urgency when it comes to climate. I've had several people approach me since the legislative session was over and say, oh, well, with what's going on in the world, with regard to the wildfires and the flooding and the extreme weather, it's got to be no-brainer to pass the Clean Energy Jobs Act. Of course, that's not the case. And it's sobering to explain why that's not the case. But that's one issue that remains challenging, setting those finite standards for closure of fossil fuel plants. Market will end up closing these plants, but as everyone familiar with CEJA knows, we wanted to do ensure that we close the plants in a way that was humane for the workers of the plants where they lost their jobs, to provide the economic support for communities that were formerly coal communities, rather than as it is currently. When a coal company closes a plant, that's it. There's no just transition. There's no opportunity to plan for a sensible, practical closure of plants. So that's something we really are pushing for. We want and need to close fossil fuel plants. Even the CEO of Vistra himself has said on multiple occasions, the end of coal is inevitable and we know it. But somehow when it comes to putting the words on paper to make it happen, it's a challenge even in Springfield, even in a blue state like Illinois. The other area where we consistently find it difficult to reach consensus is in the area of equity. What feels important to the Clean Jobs Coalition can be seen as a threat to current jobs sometimes by other parties. And again, you know, we all understand, and many legislators have been very clear about the importance of ensuring equity as we approach changes to our clean energy economy and as we build our green energy future. And that doesn't just mean jobs for the Black and people in Black and Brown communities. It means opportunities to build wealth. And now I'm on the pastor's talking points, but the opportunities to work creatively and find resources so that the ownership can be in communities that have historically been left behind. So it goes well beyond providing jobs. It goes into wealth building. It goes into the creation of opportunity. And those are things that really have to be at the forefront. So again, I remain optimistic. It's quite a slog getting through this. But I think we have, I will say this, we have the talent, we have the passion, and we have the expertise on our side. I've seen that in the negotiation room. I've seen that when it comes to organizational meetings like this. We have what it takes to get it done. We just have to make sure that we keep pushing. So that's kind of my overview. I don't know, Pastor, if that was helpful or what you were looking for, but happy to answer any questions.
Absolutely helpful. Actually, it reminds me, it was a couple of years ago, we did a radio show together as we were introducing the pillars of the Clean Energy Jobs Act. And so as we were discussing those pillars, there's a slide on the screen now, and we wanted to really kind of highlight those, what we originally thought was going to be the great bill that's going to lead Illinois to a carbon-free future, but also put us on the trajectory of being a leading state in the country when it comes to clean energy. We thought about these pillars of promoting jobs and equity and economic opportunity, especially in communities of color. As you said, that's my talking point there, making sure that we build wealth in those communities, the proper training that happens. And again, entrepreneurship opportunities could happen around clean energy. And then we talked about the pillar number two, ensuring Illinois reaches 100% renewable energy by 2050. That is still our goal. We really want to make sure that actually happens. And we know that those part of the Illinois Clean Jobs Coalition are standing firm that we really need to see a renewable energy future that does not include fossil fuels, gas, or anything like that by 2050. And then we wanted to reduce pollution and by taking diesel fuel vehicles off the road. And we know that that currently gasoline and diesel fuels are the biggest violator in pollution at this time. And then we wanted to look at achieving that carbon-free future, as you said, transitioning out of fossil fuels. We know it's inevitable, but we wanted a just transition. And even though we set a date of 2030, we've been in negotiations trying to see if we can get as close to 2030 as possible. We know that may not actually happen. But again, you have some strong advocates like you in the House that are really pushing for a green economy, a fossil fuel free environment where people can live and breathe better because we've done the right things by our state by passing a climate bill. Now, it's not called the Clean Energy Jobs Act any longer because it's been a blending of quite a few of ideas is trying to get us to the right place. So do you have any ideas if we're going to get to the right place, even though we're not going to call it CEJA any longer? Or who do you think we can lean on or push to get to the right place as far as a clean or climate legislation that's going to benefit everyone?
Well, I think, you know, you make, of course, as always, excellent points. I did glance in the chat and I saw questions on two topics that I think directly go to the question you just posed. The first person asked about the closure of the nuclear plants. And then Kevin Borgia asked about the solar cliff and the fact that it's happening and the fears that we've been trying to address and the concerns and the realities that the solar industry is facing are really coming to fruition and potentially devastating the industry, and that I guess probably you would argue is already happening. So those I would think go to this sense of urgency. To the first point, the nuclear plants. A lot of people will email or tweet at me and say, why are we giving money to a profitable plant? You know, forget Exelon, you know, we don't need them, but we do. Unfortunately, the reality is we can't snap our fingers and provide for 100% renewable energy or sufficient amounts of renewable energy to power what we need to power here in Illinois right now. So I look at nuclear as a bridge. So from my perspective, I had, and many of my colleagues agreed in the negotiating room, we had reached a consensus that limited support for the nuclear plants was a critical part of an energy package. We all recognize that despite the bad behavior of ComEd, the subsidiary of Exelon, we still need that nuclear generation in Illinois to ensure that we don't end up relying on dirty coal plants, either in Illinois or having to import that from other states. So that's probably you understand if you ask that question. I'm sure you understand and agree that nuclear is an important part of our clean energy future. So that is something. The amount certainly was under a lot of discussion, but we were able to come to consensus that that was the subsidizing of the nuclear plants in order to keep them online was a critical part of energy in Illinois and needed to happen. But we also felt that if we're going to go down that road, we need to ensure that we have hard, fast dates for the closure of these carbon emitting power plants. And we need to ensure that all this happens in an equitable manner, as the pastor discussed. And some other very critical principles were included in the bill. So the challenge of the energy bill is also why, you know, it's got so much engagement. Is it's a complicated bill with a lot of interested stakeholders, but we're not going to do a bill, nor could a bill pass that would just subsidize Exelon, nor probably, unfortunately, could a bill pass that would just institute hard dates for carbon, carbon emitting coal plants to close or other fossil fuel plants. So it kind of has to all work together. And that, of course, is the challenge. In terms of Kevin's question and my concern, very. I was supporting and pushing for a solution on the solar cliff issue since we were in Springfield at that Bank of Springfield Center. I was working with many in the solar industry and my colleagues to say, I get that energy is generally a package deal. We generally put everything in one big bill, but in this case, it was causing more harm than not to continue to push the solar issue. Unfortunately, not everybody agreed, and we are stuck with the negative, very negative impacts on the solar industry from not getting this done when we hoped to get it done. So yes, I do share concern, and that would be a huge issue in terms of urgency from my perspective. You and others in the solar industry have done an excellent job of educating me and others about how critical this issue is and how we are losing gains that we've made every day. And that is really a shame. And so that underscores my continued commitment to try and get it done ASAP.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for actually addressing both of those questions. I know I got a call from one of your colleagues, and we were very concerned about the closing of Byron. And I was letting him know that the Clean Jobs Coalition is supportive of Byron staying open, and we want to get these negotiations done as soon as possible so that, again, as our bridge to clean energy, nuclear is sustained until that actually happens. I see one more question, and because I know you have to go, Leslie McCain asked this question. CJC and labor have been talking about outstanding issues for 7 weeks now, and if we're not going to have homegrown Illinois solar business closed, then it seems like it's time for legislators to enter the negotiating room again. When do you think legislators will be a part of the negotiations that are taking place, or will you guys be jumping in anytime soon?
Well, we've been continuing to have ongoing conversations, Leslie, with all the stakeholders. I had much of a summer in terms of a summer break, but you know that's to be expected. And with something like this, I'm fine with that. So we have been involved. We're not sitting in A1 for hours at a time as we were in May and June, but we are still engaged. But I will say, you know, to the credit of the negotiators for the Clean Jobs Coalition, we have, and I maintain what I said earlier, we have the most talented, passionate, and technically proficient group of people working on this issue that are working on our side. And they have come up when there's an obstacle that's put on the table by another stakeholder, they have worked creatively to find a solution. I mean, I have so much faith in these negotiators and drafters that it got to the point I'm like, certainly you can find a way to accomplish our goal while still taking care of the concerns of this other entity or that other entity. But at the end of the day, I think all the stakeholders need to recognize that we are not going to get 100% of what we want. I think, in my opinion, the Clean Jobs Coalition has been one of those partners who has moved, who has recognized maybe 2030 is not going to be the date we're going to get for a carbon-free power sector. And we have been willing to move. The legislators have been willing to move. We want to get a deal done for the reasons we've talked about. But we don't want a deal so badly that we're willing to throw the hard dates for carbon-emitting power plant closures out the window. It then becomes a energy bill, not a climate bill. We're not willing to say, oh, we're not so worried about the wealth building and the opportunities for Black and brown contractors. We'll be fine with some strong jobs provisions. We want to see the full package for those communities in terms of equity. So there's a couple places where we will work in the negotiating room to reach agreement, but we are not willing to sacrifice. I speak for myself here, but I think I'm reflecting what I hear from many coalition partners, that at some point we have to have a climate bill. It has to be equitable, and that has to be a part of the final package. I'm not personally comfortable voting to take care of the utilities and the generators without making sure we do something about our planet and about the communities who have been most impacted, not just by pollution, but by healthcare disparities, as we've seen play out COVID, by educational, a lack of educational investment, everything else that we talk about all the time when it comes into, when we're talking about underserved communities and environmental justice communities.
So. Great. Well, your colleague, Cam, is here.
Oh, great. Cam,
and I'm gonna have him come on at this time. Cam, again, is a champion for environmental justice and climate justice. And actually, him and Ann have been working closely together to try to get this bill passed. So, Cam, if they can get you on at this point, so we can hear from you.
I am here. I'm having an issue with this video. I'm on my phone because I was in transit and not in the office this afternoon. But for some reason, when I pushed the button, it's not coming up. But I did get a chance to hear a little bit of what my good friend and colleague, Representative Williams, talked about. and I can double down and highlight some of the things that she said and say that they remain true to me and many of the members that I've spoken to, that any bill that goes on the board, any bill that we pass, has to have the climate and decarbonization at the core, and it also has to have worthwhile equity provisions. We cannot, and Ann may have said this before I jumped on, this cannot be a utility bill. This has to be a bill about the climate, about people, right? And so that, I think that's at the core of the work that both myself and Representative Williams are trying to do, and it really echoes what we've heard from our colleagues across the board about, you know, what this needs to look like. And so I'll say we've had some fits and some starts, and we're obviously not to a point today where we have found the answer to this, but I do have a great hope that we can get there because we've been very clear about what it is that's important to us.
Great. Thanks, Representative. I appreciate that. Again, we are excited that we are still in the fight, and we know that the fight is not over, and we really want to make sure that this happens. There's been a couple questions about the name of the bill, and we know that the bill's name is no longer seizure because there is a, I call it a hodgepodge of ideas that are going into climate legislation. But we know that whatever comes out is going to be one that's a just bill and holds to our values in the clean energy sector. So we want to make sure that that actually happens. And so I'm going to ask my comms team to jump in real quick and throw up a slide. We want to do a poll with you, if you can, for those that are on. I think okay. How important is it for you that a climate bill is passed in Illinois? So we want to take this poll. How important is it for you that a climate bill is passed in Illinois? And so our poller is going to let you, not important, somewhat important, extremely important.
And you should see that popping up on your screen right now. If you're just on the phone, however, you won't see it. So for those of you who are on the phone, if you have access to typing into the chat, that might be the best way you could weigh in here.
All right, we're gonna have those results in a second. Hopefully everyone had a chance to put their, very good, 93, wow, a whopping 93% of the participants said that it is extremely important, and 7% said important, and no one said not important or somewhat important. So that lets us know that we are in the right space. And again, that lets your legislators know we'll be sharing this with them in our upcoming meetings, that it is important to the citizens of Illinois that a climate bill is passed. Now, here's another question. What is most important to you in a Illinois climate bill? So we're going to have several categories for you. We want you to choose what is most important in a Illinois climate bill.
And again, if you are on the phone.
Help. Go ahead, Christina.
Sorry, if you're on the phone, you won't be able to see this. So your options are, we don't need a climate bill, health, the environment, job creation, and equity.
This is going to be interesting because we have lots of debate on what's most important in a bill. And so we'll see what. And it looks like the environment edges out at 40%. health 16%, and job creation tie. And then right behind environment is equity. Wonderful. Excellent. So thank you so much for taking those polls. We're going to share those this with our legislators and our negotiators as they continue to negotiate this Clean Energy Jobs Act or Climate Energy Bill. So at this point, we're going to, Christina, you want to take us to the next slide and as we talk a little further on some actions that we can take?
Sure. We can talk about the actions we can take, and then I'd love to hear more from Representative Buckner about maybe where we're at with what's going on, what are we trying to do, what's the landscape look like? But there are things that we can do.
Let me pause there.
Good.
Representative Buckner, with what you saw in the poll that we just took, how do you think that will translate to your colleagues in Springfield?
I think the poll that I just saw is aligned with what I've heard from my colleagues, both in the larger House Democratic Caucus and in the Legislative Black Caucus. We've talked about environment and equity having to be at the core of this, and obviously that's what was symbolized in the poll that we just took here. So we've got to talk about jobs, we got to talk about the economy, we got to talk about all of that, but we cannot miss the conversation being centered once again around the environment and about equity specifically for communities that have borne the brunt of much environmental injustice.
Great. Okay. All right. Now, Christina, we'll take you through the call to action at this point.
Very good. So there are things that we can do. Again, as a people of faith, we never give up. We never give up hope. We keep going, even when it seems like it's silly to keep going, because justice is what we're fighting for here. And sometimes it's not easy and it takes a long time, right? But we are hopeful and faithful and we will keep working. So there is a petition that will be put into the chat here momentarily that we have, that is a nifty little thing that you can click on the link. And I see that just went into the chat. And it will take you to a petition that you can sign that will be sent directly to your legislators. So wherever you might be sitting right now, whether it's East Central Illinois like me or up in somewhere north or wherever or south, you will be able to tell your representatives how you feel about clean energy and climate legislation. We would love it if you could also share that with 5 friends. You might do that through email. You might do that by passing your phone down a pew at church on whatever day you might worship. Share with other people, because other people care and our representatives need to hear from us. So get creative. You can share it on social media. You can share it personally, one-on-one, but do share with your friends that this is our best chance right now, while our representatives are not in Springfield, to let them know how we feel about clean energy legislation. You could also call your legislators, and I'll mention that when you are a elected official, you have people in your office who have to log all of these different emails and calls that come to the office. That gets tallied somewhere, and so the elected official can see, oh, wow, there are people who are calling me on this issue. Maybe I need to reach out and get educated on it, or maybe I need to read up on it, or maybe I should call some of my legislator friends and see what they're thinking about this. So it starts a conversation, and it absolutely gets attention when it's more than just one or two people contacting their legislators at once. So calling is also an option if you don't want to use the online petition, and tell them that you want comprehensive energy legislation. You could also attempt a photo petition. And this is a photo of my daughter and I that we did together. My daughter has asthma. We've lived all over the state of Illinois, truly, since she was in maybe first grade. And she has never not lived within 30 miles of an unlined coal ash pit or a coal-fired power plant or a coal mine. We have lived, like I said, in lots of places, and it's impacted her health. And so I would like a future where my child can breathe. And I would like a future where my kids can live on this planet and not worry about their future. And so I took a picture with a sheet of paper that said why I wanted a hashtag fossil free Illinois, wrote my reason, took a picture. And then I could upload that to my social media, tag my legislators. You could also tag Faith in Place so we can amplify your photo petition as well. And this just again is another way to let people know that this is important to you. And so we have all kinds of reasons why. Tell us yours. So as we are kind of still thinking about actions and what things we can do, what is something that you personally, or perhaps you might bring back to a green team at your house of worship, what is something you can do to advocate for environmental justice right now, in the next week? I'd love to see you type that in the chat and we can kind of look through those.
Great, Christina, thank you. Yeah, it's important that all houses of worship, every person have an opportunity to express their advocacy levels and how do we advocate for environmental justice. And so what we can do is just be very creative. These suggestions that Christina just shared with you are definitely tried and true. They do get the attentions of legislators. It's important to know that every call you make to your legislative office must be notated. Every time you send a petition, they definitely get it and they definitely want to hear from you. And so we definitely want you to be a part of the success of passing clean energy legislation before this year is over, and hopefully sooner than later. Thank you. And contact my local representative. Thank you, Veronica. Share a petition with congregation and social media, family. And while Christine was actually talking, I actually posted on my Facebook the petition. And so I'll be posting on Twitter in a minute. And so I use my social media platforms to try to get the information out and just to show you how easy it is. Catherine, we are joining friends from Illinois People's Action at the Illinois State Fair. Yes, we will be down there. So thank you. Hopefully I'll see you. Mm-hmm. Send an email to my representative, Bonnie. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. All right. At this time, we want to open it up for questions. Are there any
potatoes I can start?
Those are from our down here. They need to be used. So I wanted to put those cooking with the green beans.
So questions and answers. Anyone have a question? Thank you for calling your reps and governor earlier today, Kathleen. We appreciate that. Thank you so much. As we had instructed earlier, you put questions in the chat. All right. Well, we want to thank again our representative Ann Williams and Representative Cam Buckner for being champions around climate justice and their heavy lifting with getting a bill passed that's going to benefit all of Illinois. I want to thank each and every one of you that took time out your busy schedule to share with us this afternoon. Of course, I want to thank my very capable policy coordinator, Christina Crows, for doing a fantastic job and continue to do a great job. And then also I want to thank our comms team for sharing and taking us through all of the slides tonight, and we really appreciate them. So I see there may be some questions, Carl. All right, thank you, Laura, for posting that upcoming events for Faith in Place. I am super excited about our Green Team Summit that is coming up in September. Click on that link, register today so you can be a part of the process and learn. This is the year of healing, which is great. And so you want to be a part of our Green Team Summit. Of course, we can be reached by way of email. Both our emails are there posted on the slide. Mine is just as simple, scott@faithinplace.org or christine@faithinplace.org. Or you can visit any of our two websites. We have an action fund, faithinplaceaction.org. And then our C3 organization is faithinplace.org. So we would encourage you to stay in touch with us and continue to hear about the bill we believe is gonna happen. I believe it's gonna happen. I was on a call today, a negotiation call, and I know that we don't wanna share all the details of negotiations until after it's finished, but they are actually hard at work trying to get legislation passed. So have that kind of confidence that it's gonna happen. Christina, you wanna close us out?
I would love to. And, you know, we finished up a little before the hour, so I'd be happy to stay on for a few minutes if you have any questions going forward. But again, thank you for joining us. I hope that the overarching feeling you have tonight is hope. I hope the other overarching feeling you have is urgency. You know, maybe it's because of health. Maybe it's because of the environment. Maybe you have loved ones that live out west and are experiencing wildfires. Or, you know, I looked at the air quality in my, again, East Central Illinois, and it was moderate to bad today. There's haze in the air from wildfires that are traveling, you know, through the weather systems. Climate change isn't 10 years from now. It is now. And we don't have time to play around. We don't have time to cater to fossil fuel interests who don't want, you know, to cut into profit. It is time to prioritize justice for our neighbors and justice for our planet. And so it is time to make this happen. And so you have things to do. You have homework. We'll hope to see you at other potential advocacy events that you'll hear about. If you're plugged into our Faith in Place emails, you'll hear about advocacy opportunities that are coming up very soon. And with that, thank you for joining us this evening. I hope you got your questions answered. And should you have any, again, you can always connect with us by email.